physical quantities are either vectors or scalars. We shall discuss about vectors in the chapter vector algebra. Now, vector algebra means algebraic operations associated with vectors, the operations of addition, subtraction and multiplication with respect to vectors. As you might know that vectors are physical quantities which have magnitude as well as direction, unlike scalars which have magnitude only. We come across many physical quantities which are either vectors or scalars. For vectors, they have a magnitude or a value and a specific direction, such as force vector, displacement vector, velocity vector, acceleration vector, momentum vector, and so many. Now, in this chapter, we shall try to represent vectors and try to analyze the different operations associated with vectors. So, vectors, as they have a magnitude and direction, so there must be some way of representing vectors which will include their magnitude and direction. Geometrically, a vector is represented by a directed line segment. Geometrically, you can say a vector is represented by a directed line segment. So the line segment has some magnitude and a direction is specified by an arrow over the line segment. So the magnitude of the line segment, or the length of the line segment, you can say the length of the line segment in some predefined scale. The scale can be in centimeters, millimeters or meters, whichever is convenient. So the length of the line segment will represent the magnitude or the value of the vector, and the direction will be specified by an arrow. So there is an arrowhead over the line segment, and this represents the direction. But it is not very convenient way of representing a vector, because if you consider a displacement vector of magnitude say 5 meter, it is very difficult to draw to actual scale 5 meter. But if it is 5 centimeter, it might be convenient. So, if the length of the line segment is just a matter of representation, that might not be convenient provided the line segment is of larger length. That's why, in order to represent vectors, we generally use alphabets with a proper arrowhead. So say, for example, there is a vector A. We will write it as A with an arrow over it. This will be read as A vector or vector A. We can use any alphabet to represent a vector. On the velocity vector might be represented V vector, V with an arrow over it, acceleration with A. So in general, what we do is we use alphabets with the arrow over it to represent a vector quantity. And in order to associate a direction, we use the geographical directions and angles of inclination with the geographical direction. Say, for example, if there is a displacement vector which is along northeast displacement of 5 meter along northeast. So this might be represented geometrically as the geographic directions east, west, north and south, and a line segment inclined at some angle 45 degree with east, which means that it is a vector inclined at an angle 45 degree to the east or 45 degree to the north, which means the direction is along northeast. And this vector with a proper arrow over it will represent the direction and the length of the line segment from the starting point, suppose O, to the finishing point, suppose A. The length of the line segment O is suppose 5 meter. So this might be another way of representing the vectors. But if we try to draw to the actual scale, this is not convenient, because if O is indeed 5 meter, then it will be unnecessarily a very long line segment. So it cannot be drawn to proper scale, but we can just represent it. So there are many techniques of associating the direction with the vector, not only with respect to the geographical directions, but with respect to the directions as specified by the coordinate axis, we can also indicate the direction. Whenever we try to associate the direction of a vector, we use what is called as unit vector, that we will learn later. First of all, let us come across different types of vectors. So, different types of vectors is either a collinear vector or a coplanar vector, equal vectors, opposite vectors and so on. So, before going into those details, remember that if there is a line segment, a directed line segment to represent a vector, then the starting point and the finishing point are known by different names. So the starting point might be called as the origin, it might be called as the initial point, and the end point might be called as, that means the point A might be called as the terminal or the terminus or the finishing point. Now, this is required when we try to represent the vectors geometrically. Otherwise, if we just represent a vector as a vector, then it will have two parts. One is the magnitude and another is the direction. The magnitude of the vector will be represented as modulus of a vector, and the direction will be represented by a unit vector. Now, unit vector, it means that the value of the vector is 1, but it is along the direction of the given vector. So this means that this A vector will be expressed as modulus of A into A hat, where modulus of A, this is to be read as modulus of A. Now, modulus means magnitude or value, or you can say it is the absolute value of the vector. Absolute value. A velocity vector of 5 meter per second. So, 5 meter per second is the magnitude or the value or the absolute value of the vector. So, you can say that the velocity vector has a modulus of 5 meter per second, and it might be directed along any direction, say it is directed along east. So in that case, the direction will be represented by a special type of vector which is called as the unit vector. This A vector will be called as unit vector along the direction of A vector. Now unit vector has magnitude 1, because it is unit means it has magnitude 1, and it is just used to represent the direction of a given vector. So unit vector means a vector whose magnitude or modulus or absolute value is 1. A vector of modulus 1. And it is just used to represent the direction of a vector. So from this definition, you can say that unit vector is nothing but a vector divided by its modulus. So a vector, if you divide by its modulus, we will get the unit vector, that is the direction of the vector itself. So whenever we perform mathematical operations on vectors, we generally use this representation of a vector. But in order to represent it geometrically, we can use the diagrams and the angles made by the vector with a specific direction to indicate the direction property. So now, in order to associate the direction with respect to the coordinate axis, we have special names for the unit vectors. Suppose a vector is along x-axis or y-axis or z-axis. Suppose this is the x-axis, this is the y-axis, and this is the z-axis. So the unit vector along x-axis is usually called as I hat. The unit vector along y-axis is usually called as j hat, and the unit vector along z-axis is usually called as k hat. Now this vector will be read as, this will be read as a hat or A cap. Similarly, unit vector along x axis will be read as I hat or I cap, J cap and K cap similarly. If you go into the opposite directions, say for example, if you are going along the negative x direction, this will be represented as minus I hat. If you are proceeding along the negative y axis, it will be minus J hat. And if you are proceeding along the negative z axis, it will be represented as minus k hat. Remember, minus is not associated with the modulus of the magnitude. If I say that there is a vector of magnitude minus 5 meter per second, it is totally imperfect. The value of the vector is 5 meter per second. The minus indicates that its direction is opposite to what it actually was. So negative sign or minus sign is used to represent an opposite direction only. Suppose there is a vector A. If you want to proceed along the opposite direction, we will write it as minus A. So similarly, for any vector it is true that if we associate the minus symbol or the negative aspect of the vector, it is nothing but it is the opposite direction of that given vector. Minus symbol or negative value has nothing to do with the magnitude. The magnitude or the absolute value is always the positive value or the value of the vector actually. So now we shall try to realize or understand different types of vectors. The first vector is, say, collinear vectors. So collinear means vectors which are along the same direction. Vectors along same direction or along parallel lines or any parallel lines. For example, suppose there are three vectors A, B and C which are collinear. So this might be the case. All the vectors are along the same straight line. Suppose this is A vector starting from point O to point A. Starting from point O to point B, suppose there is the B vector, and starting from point O to point C, there is the vector C vector. So A, B and C are collinear vectors because they are along the same direction. So collinear vectors means that vectors acting along the same line, acting along same line, in the same direction, or acting along parallel lines, or acting along anti-parallel lines, or acting along the same line in opposite direction. So vectors acting along the same line is more precise. Vectors acting along same line or along parallel lines or anti-parallel lines are called as collinear vectors. Now, the magnitude of the vectors may not be same. They might be different. They might be same also. But the vectors are along the same line or they are along parallel lines or they are along anti-parallel lines. Say for example, the first situation, there are three vectors, A vector, B vector and C vector acting along the same line. Suppose OA vector is A vector, OB vector is B vector and OC vector is C vector. They are acting along the same line, so they are collinear. Suppose they are acting along parallel lines. Suppose this is a parallel line, this is a parallel line, this is a parallel line. They are acting along the same direction, A vector, B vector and C vector. They are collinear. Their magnitude is not necessarily the same. In this situation, A vector is acting along this direction, B vector in opposite direction, C vector in this direction. But these three lines are parallel, so they are called as collinear vectors. In the last case, A vector, B vector and C vector are acting along the same line, but A vector is in this direction, B vector and C vector in opposite direction. So they are collinear. So this is the situation of collinear vectors. Now, we might have co-initial vectors. Vectors which start from the same point are co-initial. They have the same origin, are co-initial vectors. Co-initial vectors. Vectors having the same origin. Having same origin. That means they have the same starting point. Are co-initial. Suppose this is the direction of A vector. This is B vector. So you can say that A vector and B vector have the same origin O. And so they are called as co-initial vectors. In a similar manner, you can have co-terminal vectors. Co-terminal vectors. So vectors having the same finishing point or the same terminal point, having same finishing point, are called as co-terminal vectors. Say for example, these are two vectors. Origin of vector O, vector A is O. Origin of vector B is say P. And they meet at a common point. They have the same finishing point, say X. So you can say that A vector or OX vector and B vector or PX vector are co-terminal vectors because they have the same finishing point against the point X. In a similar manner, you can also realize what is coplanar vectors. Obviously, plane or planar means that they are on the same plane. So, coplanar vectors means the vectors lying on the same plane. Coplanar vectors. Vectors lying on the same plane. Same plane. Suppose we have a common plane, might be the XY plane or the YZ plane or ZX plane or whatever it is. Suppose we have the XY plane. Suppose this is the Y axis and this is the X axis and this is the XY plane. And suppose there are vectors, A vector, B vector, C vector, which are lying on the XY plane, and then they can be called as coplanar vectors. It is not necessarily they will have the same starting point or the same finishing point or same magnitude. They can be of different magnitude, but they should lie on the same plane, and so they can be called as coplanar vectors. Now, in a similar manner, we can also realize what is equal vectors. Now, equal vectors means that they must have the same magnitude and they should point along the same direction. Vectors having same magnitude, and pointing along same direction. Same direction are obviously equal vectors. Suppose we have two vectors, A vector and B vector. Suppose this is A vector and this is B vector. Suppose the starting point of A vector is O, the finishing point is A, and this is suppose P and this is suppose B. If you say that the line segment OA is same as PB, then obviously A vector and B vector are equal in magnitude, and if they are parallel, the line OA is parallel to line PB, means that they are pointing along the same direction. And so, you can write A vector is equal to B vector. That means they are pointing along the same direction, parallel lines pointing along the same direction, and their magnitude also equal. Then only they can be called as equal vectors. We can also describe what is opposite vectors on the same term, on the same basis of equal vectors. If you say opposite vectors, then you must represent, you must realize that their magnitude is same. So opposite vector means vectors having same magnitude but pointing along opposite direction. Then they will be called as opposite vectors. Suppose in this situation, these two vectors are same, but B vector is pointing exactly opposite to A vector. These two lines are parallel, they are oppositely directed, and so you cannot say A vector is equal to B vector. In that case, you will say that A vector is minus of B vector. The minus symbol indicates that B vector is opposite to A, or you can also say that B vector is minus of A vector. That means B vector is opposite to that of A vector, or A vector is opposite to that of B vector. But you should remember that their magnitude is same. That is, whatever the direction is, their magnitude is same. That is, the modulus value of both vectors is same, but they are oppositely directed. And hence they are called as opposite vectors. So, as we proceed, we shall come across different types of vectors. But for the time being, these are the simple descriptions of different types of vectors. And as I have already told about unit vector, it is a vector which is used to indicate the direction of a given vector and its magnitude is 1. Now we shall discuss about vector addition. Before going into vector addition, you must always remember that addition of vectors is very different from the addition of scalars, because scalars have only magnitude. So addition and subtraction of scalars means the addition and subtraction of their magnitudes or values only. But while we are trying to add vectors, we should take into account both the magnitude as well as the directions. So ordinary principles of algebra cannot be used to find the summation of two vectors. By summation or addition of two vectors, we actually find the combined effect of two vectors that produces a single vector. Say for example, if we add vector A and vector B to produce a new vector C, it means that C is the combined effect of A vector and B vector. For example, a force of 10 Newton acting on a body and a force of 20 Newton acting on a body, the forces may not be in the same direction. Then what will be their combined effect? Their combined effect may be a force of 30 Newton or something greater than that or something less than that. But addition of vectors or summation of vectors is actually the technique of finding the combined effect of two vectors. Whenever we add two vectors to produce a third vector, we call the third vector as the resultant. So the resultant of a vector is actually a single vector which represents the result of the summation of a number of vectors, both in magnitude as well as in direction. Two force vectors will obviously produce a force vector. Two or more than two velocity vectors will produce a velocity vector. The nature of the vector remains the same, but the magnitude of the vector might be greater than the actual sum of magnitudes of the vectors. It might be less than the actual sum of the magnitude of the vectors. And the direction will be at some angle inclined to either of the vectors. So this is what we are trying to determine. A very important principle or important law is related to finding the addition or summation of two vectors. So this law is called as triangle law. So we are trying to add A vector and B vector to produce a third vector, which is called a C vector. Now we will try to represent A vector and B vector by the two sides of a triangle taken in the same order. Then we will realize that the resultant will be associated, or the resultant will be determined by the third side of the triangle taken in the opposite order. Say for example, A vector and B vector are the two sides of a triangle taken in the same order. Then the third side of the triangle taken in the opposite order will denote their resultant. In the opposite order. So you see that A vector and B vector are taken in the anti-clockwise sense. The resultant is taken in the clockwise sense. So A vector and B vector are represented by the two adjacent sides in the same order. The resultant is represented by the third side of the triangle taken in opposite order. This is actually triangle law. The statement is like this. When the magnitudes and the directions of two vectors are represented by two adjacent sides of a triangle taken in order, or taken in same order, the third side taken in the opposite order represents the magnitude and the direction of the resultant of the two vectors. So in order to find the resultant, we have to apply some basic principles of trigonometry. Then only we can find the magnitude of C vector in terms of A vector and B vector. What we will get actually is, if we add A and B to produce C, then what we will get is C is A square plus B square plus 2AB cos theta, where theta is the angle between A vector and B vector. Theta is the angle between A vector and B vector. Now this you can prove by the use of geometry and trigonometry, but this is what we will get. In order to know the direction, we can assume that C vector makes some angle alpha with A vector, and then we can determine alpha. Let us try to find how C becomes this and how we can find the direction. suppose this is a triangle. The triangle is suppose OAB. Suppose OA is A vector and AB is B vector, and the resultant is OB vector, that is C vector. That is, OA is modulus of A vector, which can be simply written as A. Without the arrow head, it represents the magnitude only. AB vector, or simply the magnitude AB, the line segment AB, represents the magnitude of B vector, that is B vector or B. And OB is the magnitude of C vector, that is C. Let us extend OB and drop a perpendicular from B. We extend OA to the point P and drop a perpendicular from B on P. This is obviously B vector. The angle between the direction of A vector and B vector, the acute angle, is suppose theta. And the angle made by C vector with A vector, with the direction of A vector, is suppose alpha. Now, if you use trigonometry or the Pythagoras theorem, you can find the relationship between C, A, B, and so on. Suppose in triangle A, P, B, what happens if you find cos theta? Obviously, cos theta is AP by AB, which is AP by AB means B, that is the magnitude of B vector. So AP is B cos theta. In triangle, in the same triangle, if I find sin theta, what I will get is BP by AB. That is, BB by AB is the magnitude of B vector, that is B, which means that BP is B sin theta. Now, by Pythagoras theorem, in the triangle OPB, using Pythagoras theorem, you can say that OB square is equal to OP square plus PB square or PP square. Now OB is nothing but C, the magnitude of C vector. So OB square is obviously C square. OP is actually OA plus AP. And BP is what we have already written, B sin theta. So now, if we proceed, what we get is from this step, C square equal to, instead of OA, we can write A. So that is A plus, instead of AP, we can write B cos theta whole square, plus already this is B sin theta, that is BP, B sin theta whole square, which will give you A square plus B square cos square theta plus 2AB cos theta, plus this one expanded, you will get B square sin square theta. Now, B square cos square theta and B square sin square theta. If you take B square common, you will get cos square theta plus sin square theta, which is obviously 1. So this becomes A square plus B square plus 2AB cos theta. Now, if I take square root from both sides, I will obviously get C is square root of a square plus b square plus 2ab cos theta. Now this is the magnitude of the resultant, and this is to be remembered for numericals. This is the magnitude of the resultant. If you want to find the direction, we can find it in terms of alpha. Now, in this triangle OPB, if I find tan alpha, in triangle OBP, if I find tan alpha, what I will get is BP by OP, which means that BP is B sin theta and OP is OA plus AB, sorry, OA plus AP, and OA is magnitude of A and AP is already B cos theta that we have determined, B cos theta. So now you can say that alpha is tan inverse of b sin theta by a plus b cos theta. You will learn in trigonometry about inverse trigonometric functions. Don't think that tan inverse is reciprocal of tan theta or something like that. It is totally different type of trigonometric function. It is called as inverse trigonometric function. For the timing, if you can just remember that this is tan alpha, which is b sin theta by a plus b cos theta. Later when you will learn inverse trigonometric functions, you will get alpha as tan inverse of this one. So this is the technique of finding the resultant, the magnitude of the resultant and its direction. So if there are two vectors, a vector and b vector, they produce a resultant, that is c vector, whose magnitude is given by this formula, and direction is given by this formula tan alpha equal to b sin theta by a plus b cos theta. We can also use another law, which is called as the parallelogram law, to achieve the same result. The statement might be slightly different, but the procedure is almost the same. You will get the same result by using this law, parallelogram law of vector addition.